Thank you. Dumb holes are, of course, things which cannot speak. Optical dumb holes should really be called black holes, but black holes has been hijacked by some other field. So instead, I call these optical dumb holes as things within the laboratory where light cannot escape from somewhere or other. This is work done with Malte Linder, Ralph Schutzhold, and has been published. Also, I point to you the talk this afternoon by Jacquet, who is looking at a very similar model in a slightly different situation than we are. So these are systems that light cannot escape. We can, of course, can't alter space-time in the lab. We can't make little black holes in the lab. And so we've got to make do with something else. For example, altering the refractive index of some material in the lab and trying to make a black hole or a white hole with that. Sonic dumb holes, for example, are places where we structure the flow of the fluid in such a way that in some places the fluid was flowing faster than the speed of sound and other places slower than the speed of sound. Of course, with light, that's really hard to do, to make a fluid flow at close to the velocity of light, even if the velocity of light in the material is slower than the velocity of light in free space. So one of the things we could try to do is to just build a Schwarzschild black hole. The trouble is that the index refraction has to behave in a way that one just can't make it do that. So what one does instead is you flow, instead of flowing the fluid, you flow the black hole. You have the black hole running. This was a suggestion that Ralph and I made a number of years ago by now. In which we had a lumped circuit, basically a waveguide, and in which we proposed altering the, for example, index of refraction in the waveguide to have the waves, the velocity of the waves in the waveguide go more slowly in places where the index of refraction between the capacitors, for example, index of refraction between the capacitors, if we increase that, the waves will, of course, travel more slowly. And if we move that region in which the wave, in which the index of refraction is being altered along such that the velocity of that region is greater than the velocity of the electromagnetic waves inside that region, but is less than outside, one gets an analog of a black hole. In 2010, Faccio and his group, in fact, decided to try and do this with silica glass, in which they had a large lump of silica glass, and they put a very intense laser beam in that to use the nonlinearities of the silica glass in order to change the refractive index for waves which are traveling at some other at some waves of some other frequency and try and build up a black hole like that. They saw something, and it's very interesting, and nobody really quite understands what it was that they saw. It's pretty certain that it wasn't radiation from the horizon. One of the indications was that Faccio told me that if he increased the intensity of that laser producing this pulse by a factor of less than 2, you could actually hear the pulse traveling through the material, and you'd see little brown spots where the pulse had gone by, indicating that the system had become horribly nonlinear. And that nonlinearity could do all kinds of stuff for converting electromagnetic waves. But it was a great first step. So what we want to do is, what we wanted to do was to look at a model of this kind of a system. And the simplest model is, of course, harmonic oscillators. Many Nobel Prizes have been given for harmonic oscillators. This won't qualify in any sense for that, but it indicates the power that harmonic oscillators can have. So phi here is the electromagnetic potential, one of the spatial, you know, A terms in the electromagnetic potential. The electric field is phi dot. And Q is the dipole moment of a bunch of, let's say, atoms in the material. And you may, of course, say, wait a minute, atoms in materials ain't harmonic oscillators. They're much more like two-level systems. But it doesn't really matter because a bunch of two-level systems act like a harmonic oscillator. So here I have, for example, 2n of these two-level systems, frequency separated by frequency omega. S is the spin, i.e. one-half of sigma. And we have the commutation relationships between the between these spins is the usual commutation relation. Now let's say that we just want to look at the symmetric space, in other words, the space in which we basically have the maximum total angular momentum of the system, L, which is just equal to n. And we assume that we're in a state that's very close to the ground state, namely capital S of z is equal to minus n. Then we can define a q and a p, position and momentum, given by Sx divided by square root of n and Sy divided by square root of n. The commutator between these two guys is, of course, since those are just spins, that's Sz. But if Sz is very close to n, this is just equal to I, which is precisely the commutation relation between the momentum and the position. Furthermore, the Hamiltonian, omega squared p squared plus q squared, can be written in terms of the spins, and it's just equal to the Hamiltonian for this two of this bunch of two-level systems, plus terms which go as 1 over n, plus constants, and nobody cares about constants in the Hamiltonian. So if one has a whole bunch of two-level systems, they act like a harmonic oscillator, at least if they're near their, fairly near their ground state. So the harmonic oscillator approximation is actually quite a good approximation. And here's the Hamiltonian for the system. Q is the dipole moment, and that acts like a harmonic oscillator. Phi is the vector potential, and so this is an E dot D coupling. And then the electromagnetic field, of course, obeys the usual relativistic wave equation. These are the coupled equations of motion. And one can eliminate phi from these equations of motion, assuming that epsilon is a constant. It's not going to change. But omega could change. And so we get this very complicated fourth order differential equation in time for this system. We're going to assume that these frequencies of these harmonic of these two-level systems or of the harmonic oscillators can be altered externally. For example, a strong electric field could give you things like Stark shifts, which would lower the frequency of these oscillators. But we're not going to look at the quantum mechanics of that. We're going to assume that that's just a classical shift. If we assume that capital omega is a constant, then we get this dispersion relationship here. And this dispersion relationship is interesting. Usually in these analog gravity devices, one has omega as some complicated function of k. You know, some polynomial function, or not even polynomial, some complicated function of k. This is a case in which k is some complicated function of omega instead. So it operates somewhat differently than the usual analog system. If one looks at the phase velocity, which is just omega squared over k squared, phase velocity squared, which is just omega squared over k squared, but since I can, these equations are linear in k squared, so I can solve for k squared and then look at 1 over k squared over omega squared instead, I get this relation here. So this term here is basically the index of refraction of the material. And we notice it has exactly the so-called Selmayr form, single pole Selmayr form. Now, for most materials, a three-pole solution is a good approximation. But for a few materials like diamond, the single pole is actually a very good approximation for the way in which things happen in diamond. And we're going to be interested always that frequencies are less than this, the resonant frequency capital omega. This, of course, also means that the phase velocity in the lab is always less than 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to have, via some external procedure, a way of having a region here in which the phase velocity is lower than it is without that external agency. And we're going to have this moving along with some velocity v. That velocity v is chosen in such a way that it's larger than the velocity of the co-propagating waves inside that pulse and is smaller outside the pulse. So in the frame of this frontier, these waves are trapped. They can't get out. They're always left behind. These waves, of course, can get out. So this thing acts just like the horizon of a black hole. Now, in this diagram, I've got a very sharp transition. What we are going to look at is a very smooth transition. So if the transition rate is much for example, much slower than 1 over omega. Here's an example, a simple example. G epsilon we're going to assume as a constant, which we call G naught. Omega, we choose two possibilities for omega, and the velocity in this case turns out to be, the velocity of the pulse is 2/3, and we find that the phase velocity outside is up here. There's a smooth transition to a phase velocity inside. Here, that phase velocity also depends on frequency. So if one gets the frequencies that are starting to get close to omega, we find strong differences in the effective refractive index. Whoops. So what we want to do is we want to do a Lorentz transformation to go into the rest frame of the pulse. And if we do that, then the time, the Lorentz transform time is tau, and the Lorentz transformed x we'll call chi. This term, of course, it's Lorentz invariant, and so we just get d tau squared minus d chi squared. But the terms which are just the ordinary derivatives of q pick up these extra terms, both of the gamma factors and of the velocity of the front of the pulse. Well, this is sort of a messy equation. In particular, one can, because of the transformation, omega is a function only of chi, so frequency is a conserved quantity, and we can do the separation of variables and just get a single equation for chi that I can try and solve. And we notice it's a bit of a mess. And in particular, it's a strong, it's a fourth order polynomial in omega. Second thing we can do is we can define, we can still define a conserved charge, the conserved Noether charge, which is basically the momentum times the field strength. The momentum in this case is d by dt, d by d tau plus gamma g naught times q. There's actually supposed to be, no, that's right. It's the imaginary part of this whole thing. And that forms an inner product, which is, of course, not a positive definite inner product. And the modes which have a positive inner product we associate with annihilation operators, and the modes with a negative inner product we associate with creation operators. Most of you learned in your quantum field theory courses that it's positive and negative frequency. That's just wrong in most situations. It happens to be okay in most of the ones that your quantum field theory people looked at, but it's the positive and negative norm modes that are important, not the positive and negative frequency modes that you should be talking about. We get this dispersion relationship for the system, omega minus vk, which, and now that thing is a function not only of k as it is in the usual situation, but is a function of both k and omega on the right-hand side, which makes things a little bit messier. Here's an example. if the frequency, if we're in the external region, then, and omega is small enough, then we find that there are always four roots to the equation, four values of k. The other one is, of course, way over here. This is what happens as capital omega varies. For example, as we decrease omega and we get into the interior region, that thing which started off having four roots now only has two roots. Similarly, over here, as we vary omega, we can figure out what the group velocity is by looking at dk by d omega, which is the same as d omega by dk. And we find that the various points have different group velocities. Here, as omega increases, as omega increases, we notice that this, this intersection here moves off to the left. So that tells us the waves are traveling in one direction rather than the other. Inside, of course, there are only two real solutions for k, and the other two poles of the other two roots of the fourth order dispersion relationship will, of course, be complex. So one has to try and match things up. If one's far enough away from this horizon, WKB should be a good approximation. And those are basically the WKB solutions that we looked at. Once you get near the horizon, however, WKB goes to hell. Well, it turns out there's a way of doing WKB even close to the horizon, but that's not what we did here. So in order to mimic a black hole, which goes as 1 minus 1 over 2m over 2m over r, or r minus 2m, etc., we can make omega be a linear function of chi in the region around the horizon. That's going to mimic the metric of a the effective metric of a black hole. The horizon is going to occur at chi equals 0. And we're going to assume that in that region we can solve the equations via, it turns out, saddle point techniques. And as we get far enough away from chi equals 0, we'll go over to WKB. So omega doesn't have to be linear in chi everywhere, just in a sufficiently large region around the horizon that one can do the saddle point approximation for the solutions in that regime. The differential equation looks like this, and the nice thing about this differential equation is that one can basically solve for the d by d chi kinds of terms. One can do a Fourier transform of this system. Sorry, one can do a Fourier transform. This chi here turns into the derivative of k, the Fourier transform of chi, and these terms just turn into multiplications. Well, that gives us a first order ordinary differential equation in k. And we can solve that. No special techniques are required. We just get this rather complicated equation here, but we know we can always solve that by quadrature, and we get a solution for q that looks something like this. There's some function f, which has got some complex has got some poles in it at k equals plus or minus omega. Notice that the exponent here is complex. It's not a real exponent. Plus the h, the term that enters into this exponent over here, also has some points, has some branch cuts, which one has to take into account, and one has to suitably choose the contour. So here, for example, is the situation if we're outside the black hole. One has these two poles at k equals plus or minus omega, complex poles, and one has these branch cuts at ks plus and ks minus. here's a form, and in these directions, the exponent becomes negative, so as you go far enough away, you go down the valley, and they don't contribute anything. So one can do contour integrations by coming up from one of these valleys and then choosing an appropriate path past all these poles, etc., to go back down into this other valley over here. These points are actually saddle points. And if we look over here, here we see the poles. This is a two-dimensional diagram, so this is complex K-space. And this is the value of the absolute value of the this is the absolute value of the function, and we notice that we get these branch cuts, one big branch cut over here and one little branch cut over here. So for this region, we are going to take our contour here going through this saddle point down here, and these guys are branch cut. These guys are branch cuts, and these guys are saddle points. Going through this saddle point over here, and we can do all of those integrals. Similarly, if we go to the other side of the horizon, we get the same kind of thing. Now our saddle points sit out here, and we've got to run our branch, our contour up into that other regime where you're going down the where the function is going downhill, but we then have to go ahead and avoid those branch cuts. And so we can do the integrals along the branch cuts, and we also get these two contributions from the two saddle points. Anyway, these are the kinds of results that you get. It's not going to be terribly illuminating. One can look at the densities, the current densities coming out of these, each one of these contributions from the saddle point and from the branch cuts. And we find various terms like this. These are the currents coming from the cuts. These are the currents coming from the saddle points. And one finds that there are three different terms that become important. If one is looking at the Hawking output flux, then there are three input modes that contribute, not just two, as one usually has in the simple situations. Beta squared, this coefficient beta squared, tells us how many particles come out in these Hawking modes. N isn't thermal. If one looks at the expression for N, it's a complicated function and it's not thermal. And you might say, well, that indicates that this system isn't thermal. But one gets exactly the same situation in a black hole. We know in a black hole that the horizon is thermal, but if you look far away from the horizon, some of that thermal radiation hits these effective potentials, which I'll see soon, and gets reflected back into the black hole. So what leaks out to infinity is in fact a spectrum that doesn't look thermal. At low frequencies, you get almost no particles coming out, and it's only once the frequency gets high enough to go over the top of the effective potential that you actually get something that looks like a thermal spectrum. Exactly the same kind of thing is happening here. We can calculate the Hawking temperature as the derivative of the effective gravity at that horizon, and one gets the expression like this, where that xi is the slope of the omega function, v is the velocity of the wavefront, etc. This is the effective metric. And we can define a new sort of, if you will, tortoise time or null time and a tortoise coordinate, just as one does in Schwarzschild. And one finds that the effective metric looks like some conformal factor times this two-dimensional metric. But you can't simply model the system by a two-dimensional metric. One of the things about a two-dimensional metric is that the scalar field equation is conformally invariant. And the equation we have is not conformally invariant. But one can get around that by introducing a third dimension and simply saying that we are only going to look at modes which are constant in that third dimension. So d by dy never occurs in any of the equations of motion because everything is constant in that third dimension. But in order to get a metric theory, an analog to a metric theory, one needs that third dimension in order to get around this conformal invariance problem. That also leads to the fact that the system then has an effective potential. And this is what the effective potential looks like for this optical model. It's very, very similar, well, not very, very, it's similar to the effective potential you get for the black hole, except, of course, you've got some places where the effective potential goes to zero. In fact, it's such that the appropriate integral of that previous effective potential is equal to zero, which means that the transmission coefficient through that effective potential doesn't go to zero as omega goes to zero. In the Schwarzschild case, as you get to very, very low frequencies, almost none of the wave gets through. In this case, that negative part of the effective potential accelerates the particles so that they now have enough energy to penetrate through the rest of that effective potential. And instead of getting zero transmission at low frequencies, you get a finite transmission at low frequencies, depending on the slope and depending on V and various other features. So what one tends to get in general is this kind of situation. You get radiation coming from the horizon, which hits the effective potential. Some of it gets reflected back in this case, into the counterpropagating mode, the mode that was originally traveling in towards the black hole rather than away from the black hole horizon. And some of it then gets out as what one would call Hawking radiation. To figure out what the temperature is, however, one has to look at the situation over here, not the particles coming out over here. And one can do that by looking at this ratio of these factors beta over omega, beta over alpha squared, where beta and alpha are the coefficients for the various modes that we had in the original thing. Eta is the coefficient that corresponds to this mode going in here. And one gets exactly a thermal spectrum. A thermal spectrum, furthermore, with exactly the expected Hawking temperature. So this is, in a sense, a really nice model in that it behaves in so many ways in just the same way as a black hole would behave. And that's the end of anything I have to say.